everyone, welcome to Magic TV. I am Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Louise Scott-Vargas. By request today, top 8 Conley-est cards.
The Conley-est of the Conley cards.
What makes a Conley-est Magic card?
All right. So there are a couple things that go into it. One is that it involves the destruction of lands.
More often than not.
Yes. Two, it's a card that he has either tried to play a lot, played a lot, or wanted to play a lot, but maybe not quite gotten there.
That's why we have the experts here. People like Luis Scott-Vargas are the ones that are sitting in the rooms where it's like, I got a sweet
no,
new
Conley,
brew.
No, Conley, Conley, that's bad. No, Conley. Oh, Conley, that could be... No, okay, no, sorry, Conley. No, I mean, Conley, you know, he... Much like any creative mind, you have to come up with a lot of bad ideas to come up with a good one. And that's just true of anything. So, you know, I'm not going to go into the ratio we've got here, but let's just say his deck building has led to some pretty interesting cards.
Now, these aren't like necessarily bad cards. They're not cards no one's ever played with.
No, certainly. In fact, there are some actual good cards on the list.
Right. I think that's why we have to start with a card like Lotus Cobra, because that's a good magic card.
Lotus Cobra is just a good card. I mean, but the reason it's a Conley card is because when someone looks at Lotus Cobra, you think, Lotus Cobra, what can I cast with this? Jace the Mind Sculptor, yeah, that'd be a good thing to cast with this. Vengevine, maybe. Conley looks at it and he thinks, what can I cast with this? Oh, a Cruel Ultimatum, Genesis Wave for 15, a Frost Titan. I mean, this is what Conley thinks. And Lotus Cobra has been the engine that powers his decks many, many times.
Right, it's usually Lotus Cobra into card that produces land death. You know, that's very popular.
I mean, he had the Magic for Christmas land at Worlds in 09, where he's casting violent and cruel ultimatums and mold shamblers and acidic slimes, I believe.
I don't know. We'll have to wait for that one.
To his Genesis Wave deck, where he's casting
again acidic slimes.
Frost and Primeval Titan and Genesis Waves. So, yeah, Conley likes to do things with this card. Things that most people would not consider.
One of the cards you definitely wouldn't consider about anything other than maybe Mirrodin Besieged Limited would be Peace Strider.
Yeah, Peace Strider. This is a card I still remember in Dallas when he comes up to the CFB booth like, all right, Tristan, I need cards. You're like, what do you need? He's like, I need Peace Striders, 3 of them or whatever.
Yeah, I was like, I'm just like, okay, well, we have cards. We can help you. And I'm like, so I have to crack packs to get these?
Conley, you should go look at the draft table, see what the garbage people leave behind. So Peace Strider was featured in his blue-black deck as a way to stabilize against aggressive decks. All right, well, I mean, let's just say card development has taken great strides since many years ago, and we no longer have to play Bottle Gnomes.
Sometimes I just want to get in the head, and we're like, well, it just completely trumps...
Just get a little piece of Conley's mind.
Step links, maybe?
No, Peace Strider.
Something? Yeah. I'm not sure.
Only Conley.
He's obviously playing Venser. I don't know. Speaking of more life gain, then, let's talk about Martyr of Sands.
Oh, yeah. Martyr of Sands is definitely a Conley favorite. He played it at Pro Tour Austin in 2009, and, you know, his Martyr of Sands, Soren Markov, Proclamation of Rebirth, Ranger of Eos deck, which, yeah, I mean, it did what it did, which is to say, gained a lot of life.
I was going to say, are you just trying to prolong the game as long as possible?
Well, the idea is to lock out the aggressive decks and presumably have disruption to beat the combo decks, and yeah. The problem with Martyr of Sands decks from the beginning of time is against decks that don't attack your life total, like, you know, aggressively, you don't do that much. You just gain a crap load of life. And against some decks, that's just not good enough. So he played that. I think he played it at Grand Prix LA, because I remember him playing Roiling Horror, and I think Martyr of Sands went into that. But I could be wrong. So
Okay.
I'm not a complete Conley historian.
Expectations were high. I mean, I guess we could just go deeper then for the Ninja of the Deep Hours.
Yeah, I mean, Conley's returned all sorts of things with this. He's returned Gatekeeper of Malakirs for additional value. He's returned Spellstutter Sprites, Vendilion Clicks, Abyssal Persecutors. So Conley likes going deep, and Ninja of the Deep Hours is certainly one of the ways he does so.
So much value. I mean, how can you not get behind this card?
You have to attack with things.
Have you never done that?
I mean, I try not to.
Usually when you're attacking with guys, they're of every other color other than blue, right?
Yeah, and they're just like, you know, straight up beatdowns. I think one of Conley's regrets is that he did not play his Ninja of the Deep Hours Gatekeeper deck in Worlds 09 again, where he had to go, like, he was 10-2, so he had to go, like, 3-2-1 to top 8, and he played Zoo, and yeah, it did not work out so well, so... He was convinced not to play his brew, which is the last time anyone's ever been able to do that.
Wow, that is, yeah, that'll teach you.
Yeah.
Well, talking about more sweet brews, especially for Worlds, let's talk Necrotic Ooze then.
Oh yeah, Necrotic Ooze is definitely a Conley card. He he just looks at that and thinks, what abilities can I put on this thing to make it sweet? And the answer was, of course, Full Meter Mage and Acidic Slime to destroy their lands. Though obviously it doesn't copy the slime, but
halfway there.
Yeah. Turn one, birds. Turn two, Fulminator Mage. Turn three, ooze. Kill your land. Turn four, slime. Conley Woods. So, but yeah, Necrotic Ooze, he comboed off with Grim Poppets and what's the other one that eats counters to get big? The like 3-mana 1/1 guy. Somebody's drawing a blank on
his name. Like Spike, Quill Spike, and Quill Spike, Devoted Druid. Like, you gotta put that combo under the graveyard.
Yeah, so Necrotic Ooze, I mean, it broke out on that tournament. Ended up not being the best afterwards, but Conley doesn't design decks to be good for 6 months. He designed to be good for one tournament.
For 1 second.
And, you know, sometimes it works, and you need your deck to be good for the tournament you're playing, and you don't need to worry about making it resilient for later. Like, that doesn't matter.
Well, I mean, I think, you know, no choice on this list is more apparent than a card that was just amazing for one tournament than Kazul. Was it Tyrant of Cliffs?
Yeah, amazing for one tournament. that's what I want to say. All right, so, yeah. Conley's played this card in not one, but two different Pro Tours. He played it in San Diego, and he played it in Paris. So, yeah, I mean, what does Kazul go well with? Well, what if they can't pay the three? What if they don't have any lands?
Oh, man. He's already got me. I didn't know. Yeah.
So, yeah.
It's like creatures?
Yeah. Kazul Tyrant of Cliffs is a Conley standby, and, I mean, he's a powerful card. I've definitely lost to him before, you know, in Limited.
Ah, there we go. Yeah.
But, hey, I mean, if you want to destroy their lands, I mean, this is a good finisher, right?
I guess. 5 power for 5 is not.
Well, sometimes when you're destroying their lands, they play all these creatures because you're busy destroying lands. Right. Then you play this and they can no longer attack you.
I mean, it makes sense. You need the answer after the answer.
Exactly. So, yeah, Kazul Tyrant of Cliffs, definitely done some tyranting in Conley's time.
To me, that's like, I mean, Conley Woods is known for the surprise decks, the surprise card choices.
Right.
To me, that's the biggest surprise we could make, because when you get to the end of this list, it's almost obvious. I mean,
if there's two cards that are more Conley than the next two, I don't know what they are.
You know, Abyssal Persecutor, the first place I ever saw it was on his Facebook page. I think he saw the spoiler and immediately just
boom, bam. He was done. I mean, Conley spent his entire retirement fund on Abyssal Persecutor. So just, you know, he's got 2,000 of them, and that's why he keeps playing decks to break them, because one day he'll break them, and then Abyssal Persecutor will skyrocket in price.
Some people have 401k plans.
Yeah, he's got
a vault.
And sometimes they have six tramplers. So
they don't actually win you the game.
Well, they do the opposite. But I mean, Abyssal Persecutor is a powerful card, and if you can negate the drawback, which his decks generally do, it does finish games. I mean, he tends to pair it with cards like Gatekeeper to kill it, Jace to bounce it, Ninja of the Deep Hours to bounce it.
Right. Noticing a trend here. These are all things that he likes to play.
Removal spells that can target it, like Go for the Throat or whatever. And, yeah, I mean, Abyssal Persecutor never has lived up to quite its fullest potential, or the potential people thought it was going to. It's not the worst card on the list, that's for sure. it's still, I mean, this is a card Conley's played in so many decks that I can't even count that high. So, but not as many decks as number one, which I'm sure we all know who it is.
There's no one good story. I think Zame recently, when we were talking, he's like, yeah, you know, I sit on Magic Online all the time. I'm home late, and Conley messaged me one night. He's like, I need some commons on commons. First thing Zame says is, how many Acidic Slimes do you need? And the next line of text is 4.
Yeah. Yeah. So Acidic Slime is the most Conley-est of cards. It's slightly overcosted. It's not that big, but it destroys a land. And it technically has the utility to destroy other things other than lands. So that's like an excuse to put it in your deck when really he just wants to destroy a land.
It has Death Touch. It trades with anything. It already
But it's also
something.
An incremental value card, which Conley likes too. So yeah, land death is a big recurring theme. I've played Acidic Slime before, so I can't say it's the worst card, but yeah, Acidic Slime, the old slime baller, Conley's, you know, rolled that one out and God, like 10 different decks.
Am I the only one feeling that he decided to play competitive Magic like 12, 13 years too early? I mean, he does know there was a time where you had like Rashad and Port, Pillage, Stone Rain, all in the same format.
I mean,
I guess he did.
But see,
at
that point,
things?
He probably wouldn't have wanted to play those because that was too mainstream.
Right? Oh, okay.
He wants Landeth to be come out of nowhere, and you know, he's had success with it. I mean, you know, his Mannequin, you know, deck or whatever that Brad played to the top 8 of Nationals, like. Conley certainly designed some sweet decks. He was the first person to use Stoneforge Mystic in a tournament. And his Bant deck at GP Oakland, where he had a pair of Stoneforge Mystics. I mean, that was the first person to ever use it, and he deserves some credit for that. His Bant decks, he always does well with them. And his Bant decks are among his best decks, I think. he makes this Bant deck and extended quite often with like Noble Hierarch, Vendilion Click, you know, Jace, Jit, you know. One of these cards were legal at various times, you know, whatever. Like, just basically kind of like a tempo Bant deck with creatures and some light counter magic and some removal. And, you know, he did well with it in Amsterdam. He did well with it at, he top eight at our top four at Oakland. Like, these decks are sweet, and I think Conley really knows how to build them right.
I think Amsterdam
stays away from the land death.
Amsterdam, he had an interview with BDM, but I think they talked about he was building it literally the night before. Yeah. So it definitely seems like something that he can put together very well. And it makes sense what you like. It has blue cards in it.
It does. And he's got it down. He knows what it takes to build a successful deck. And, you know, that's kind of the mark of a good deck builder. So, yeah, Acidic Slime, definitely the top card, though.
How many Conley Woods brews have you played?
well, you see.
Excellent deck builder. Incredible magic player.
We played Mutagenic Growth in our sideboard in Nagoya, and it was instrumental in, you know, us doing well, and it was Conley's idea. And granted, he had it in a deck with Mirren Crusaders, but still, we saw the potential.
That's okay. I beat him in a cube draft where I put Rancor on Mirren Crusader, and neither of us noticed for a little while.
Yeah, you guys are mongoose. But
we were at the side table while you were XO-ing.
Let's go to honorable mentions. There's definitely a couple. Evan Mind Sensor, Flash, Land Death, because it kills it kills fetch lands.
right in there with the Bant deck.
Yep. Yeah. Can wear a Jit, can bounce up for Ninja of the Deep Hours. He was you can reveal it to Martyr of Sands.
You know, going back to PT Nagoya, you know, I was going to say, like, you know, he was there with the Mutagenic Growth. It was obviously huge for you guys. Morning of, though, looking for Furnace Scamps. Yep. That was the card that he was looking for.
He ended up not playing those in his deck, but yes, they were in the deck for quite a while. You can't mention Conley Woods without mentioning Fetchlands. Crack, fetch, take two. I'm Conley Woods, but... I'll go into that more when
a little more of an inside story, but he's a big fan of starting games with very low life totals, so you could cast any number of
basically
things.
At Worlds, let's just, a short abbreviation, his opponent playing Burn, the all Lava Spike deck, mulled to three, and Conley went, you know, turn one, crack, fetch, Shockland, Curt Ape, turn two, crack, fetch, Shockland, Sign and Blood Myself, turn three, crack, fetch, Shockland, Dark Tutelage. So that's the long and the short of it. But he followed up with Ad Nauseam on turn five. But, so fetch lands are definitely a Conley Woods card. And who knows? We'll see what Conley thinks. We'll see how many of these he got right. I'm sure we got some of them right, but I'm sure he's got some other brews that we just had no idea about. Conley's got a long history, and, you know, I've only started really testing with him the last couple of years, or last year or so. So
Diverse
list. Yeah, he hits all the notes. So.
Well, you got to make sure, you mean, like, you know, again, I'm thinking of the testing room. You got to have somebody who's way out there.
Yeah, of course. And Conley's definitely that.
Yeah.
So. Thanks for watching, and may you play Conley cards to great success.
Hey everyone, welcome to Magic TV. This is a special or an extra or the other half of a segment. I am Tristan Shaun Gregson.
Well, first of all, everything with me is special.
There you have it. It's a special. We're here with Conley Woods. A while back now at this point, so long that I've thankfully forgotten, Luis and I recorded the top eight Conley Woods cards by request from our viewers. And we finally, despite all of the problems we have with our radio tower and trying to get you in, you're here to tell us what your top eight cards are. We can match it up at home against our list, see how Luis and I did as a team versus what the true.
Yeah, I specifically picked cards that I've played with, although there are plenty of cards that I've tried making work for years that I've never gotten actually to throw in a deck. But these are specifically cards I've played with over the course of my... magical existence.
I will say that I am already proud of Luis and myself. I think we did a pretty good job here.
I mean, some of them are pretty obvious.
Well, right. I mean,
I do have a token with like three cards on it.
And you have to understand, we recorded this before you had a token.
That's fair.
And we only got two out of three on the token.
Well, my favorite card no one really knows about.
That's probably this honorable mention right here at the top of our list here. Again, this is not me shining anything on. He even wrote in honorable mention.
I did. I put honorable mention right on there.
Give it away. We have Wee Dragonauts, so give it away. Why?
It's just my favorite card ever. I don't know. When it saw print, I love the card. I've won vintage tournaments with this card.
That's a pretty big deal.
Using, what's it called? I think it's like Psychotic Furies. The double gives a
double
strike.
That was a really sweet limited trick.
Yeah.
But way to get that into vintage.
Yeah. It was like Lightning Bolts and Force of Wills and Rebs and stuff like that. This is like 5 years ago. But like you just like burn them out and you just counter burn. And you just use that because it just kills it very quickly. And your Berserk is your Psychotic Episode. Or Psychotic Fury, whatever it is.
Okay.
Yeah, but I don't know.
So it didn't actually play Psychotic Fury.
No, it did. It played whatever the card, the colorless red target with double strike.
Yeah.
Yeah, it played those.
And Berserk.
No, not Berserk. It was
you didn't play Berserk.
Berserk wasn't legal in those colors.
Okay. You were playing Vintage, right?
It was Vintage, yes.
Okay. Because you could play all the colors you want.
I won a bunch of store credit with this deck. That's I understand great. You could play all the colors you want.
So there you go. Honorable mention.
Berserks were like really expensive. Give me some credit here, okay?
All right, honorable mention.
They're expensive.
Now, number eight. What's the real answer, number eight? Your number eight card. Or I'm just going to say it then.
Yeah, you can
Genesis,
say it.
Genesis Wave.
That Apollo gave me, I was trying to think of what my eighth card could be, and Apollo gave it to me, and it's actually pretty accurate. I love that card. It's like, so I like cards that they're like engines, but you have to like do some wacky stuff to get them to work.
I like the word wacky. I think that applies a lot. So, Genesis Wave is wacky.
Yeah, I played, I top aided a 5K event in Kansas City earlier this year with it, playing blue-green with a bunch of land destruction cards, one of which may be also be on this list.
Maybe, come on.
And by destruction, I mean death, of course.
Obviously.
I was trying to keep it PC, but it's land death. And then, but yeah, no, I just like the card. It does some degenerate things, assuming you can get to that point. And that's the kind of cards I like.
They're now,
like,
was it Worlds last year that you played Genesis Wave?
No. This was Kansas City. It's the only time I've played it in.
Only in Kansas City? I thought it was like December, January, because you and Dave were playing it.
Dave played it at Worlds. I helped him with the list, but I didn't actually play it.
Oh, okay. That's the amalgamation.
I played the Vampires.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Number seven, Battle of Wits.
I love some Battle of Wits.
Do you want to tell your best Brad Nelson Battle of Wits story, or do you want to
No, we're not going to tell. That would happen in a PTQ before either of us were doing anything. It was not even that exciting. But
tweet at him if you want this story, because it's a good one.
I was playing Battle of Wits.
Get it down to 140 characters.
I was playing Battle of Wits in Extended during the height of Dredge, like 2008 era.
So was that really bad for Battle of Wits?
Like, no, Battle of Wits had an awesome matchup against it. I had things like, I got to main deck a bunch of cards like Relic of Progenitus that other people couldn't.
Oh, you
I
got
had,
to main deck everything, I'm
I
sure.
Got, I had Cunning Wishes for like, you know, extra pates or whatever in that genre. I had Ghostly Prisons and Collective Restraint, which are both awesome against Dredge. I had like all these main deck cards other people couldn't afford to put in their deck. So even though I had a huge deck, and I had maybe 20 really good Dredge. Stop. Even though I had a huge deck and there was only like 20 to 25. There was like 20 to 25 Dredge hate cards. That was percentage-wise more than everyone else had main deck cards because they couldn't afford it.
Right. So you'd get there on the natural a lot of game ones. Yeah, and your Dredge opponents are just like, what the hell?
I went like 6-2, like three straight PTQs with playing Battle Wits. It was super fun. I wanted to play it in Legacy this year for a tournament that there was a big contest, basically play your best Battle Wits that Kenny Mayer ended up winning. I didn't get to go to the tournament to play it in there, but I would have. I love Battle Wits. There's just so much stuff you can do with it. It's just an awesome card. You get to do a lot of fun stuff.
Battle Wits sounds like fun. The only thing that doesn't sound fun is a tournament full of people playing it.
No. This was not a tournament. This was a big Legacy tournament.
Oh, okay. I thought and it was like a there was Battle like Wits a challenge.
No, there's like a pool of people that any of them could pay a certain, you know, whatever, and then enter the tournament with Battle Wits, and then the highest finisher won a prize.
Oh, that's exciting.
Yeah.
We should recreate that somehow. Number six, we've got Wildfire with a shout-out to Destructive Force.
They're the same card, right? But Wildfire was my favorite before Destructive Force.
I completely agree. I wouldn't even bother adding Destructive Force on here, but you wrote this thing.
Well, people, some current people, you know.
So Kai made this card actually good. What makes it a Connolly Woods card?
I played it in my first ever Grand Prix that I took 10th at, which with another card on this list. It was just, I just love the card. First of all, it blows up lands. So, second of all, one of the problems with blowing up lands is if you blow up lands and they have a creature in play, you don't really get very far ahead because you're just getting beat in the face.
Right. They keep damaging you.
This solves that problem of let's kill all your creatures and your lands simultaneously. And it's, again, another engine you have to work towards a little bit. You can't just play it and then, you know. But I just love the global effect. There's so many ways to abuse it. I mean, if Wildfire were legal in Standard, I'd probably be playing it at Worlds.
Wow. It's not. That sounds like a complete Wizards of the Coast to me.
Well, they printed Destructive Force instead, which is worse.
Did you convince Eric to play it, or did he play it on his own?
He played that on his own. I did win a TCQ thingy with a Destructive Force Primeval Titan deck before Valakut was a deck. That was a fun deck.
Wow, before Valakut was a deck.
Well, yeah, it was like nobody's playing Primeval Titan. It was like right after the Titans got released.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah, it was pretty fun.
Yeah. I had a similar rug Planeswalker
nobody
thing.
Nobody cares before, about before, you. We're here for me.
Before, yeah.
Let's move on.
All right. Number five and Bitter Ordeal.
Dude, Bitter Ordeal's the nuts.
Owen
may have won the Vintage World Championships the same year that I played two Bitter Ordeals in my main deck and one in my sideboard in Vintage. With another card on this list, of course.
Did you? They're all ones we haven't got to yet.
Yeah, they're all ones we haven't got to yet. So, dude, the card was so good. I had a feature match at Gen Con where I was playing against like an Oath player, and I, like, you know, it was like Wasteland, that land, break this fetch land, Bitter Ordeal, take all your win conditions, nice Oath. And he had Oath in play, but he would just deck himself. So I just won the game. Right. But like, it's just a card I've always wanted to build around because it's like, you, again, it's an engine you have to work towards, but if you cast it for enough, depending on what your opponent's deck is, you can just deprive them of win conditions completely. Like, Cranial Extraction, that sort of effect, you have to name a card, and usually they have multiple answers. But this, like it, if you, you know, you do it for five or whatever, there's a likely chance you could take all of Control's win conditions.
Ah.
Or, and in older formats where Storm is legal, you have an easier chance of fueling this. You know, you break a Lotus Petal, you break a Lotus, whatever. So I played it in a Vintage World Championships. I started that one 4-0 and then lost my last three due to not being smart. I built my deck like an hour before the tournament, and I was not smart enough to include a way to remove my Mana Crypt. So I lost a lot of Mana Crypt flips.
There we go.
I was black, white, splashing Ancestral and Timewalk, and had no way to get rid of a Mana Crypt and just died.
No Chain of Vapor, no nothing.
Nothing.
Interesting.
It was not smart thinking on my part, but Bitter Ordeal did its job.
Bitter Ordeal is fun. Bitter Ordeal is, again, totally reasonable for Vintage.
You say that like anybody else will play the card ever.
Well, I'm just saying, like, you know, I've played Jester's Cap in Vintage before because I could cast it on turn one or two, and you could do something similar here. And there used to be these things called Groatog decks. Like, they used to play a couple Psychotogs and maybe some Korean Dryads, and this could finish them off very quickly. I definitely had an opponent in Vintage once when I was playing Workshop. I took his two togs out of his deck, and he proceeded to play some turns without realizing that it happened.
So you played Vintage back when the Spice Girls were popular?
Yeah.
Did you listen to the Spice Girls while you played Vintage?
Not during. I mean, before and after, obviously.
All right. I'm sure one of them's Canadian. You got blood ties there.
I have blood ties there. Aren't they all British?
I don't know. They're not. They're probably all fake British people.
True. You know, you make Brian Kibler's tangents look way more reasonable.
What are you talking about?
Number four on this list. Only number four.
Well, see, there's a huge misconception. Name the card.
Acidic Slime's got to be number one. Are you kidding me?
No. The problem is other people play the card, so it's not strictly my card.
Oh, it's not a Conley-est card.
Second of all, sometimes it doesn't see play as a four of, so it's like a two to target or whatever. So it's less of an engine. It's more of a card. I mean, I love blowing up a land. I like the versatility of it. I may have played four of these in Extended last year at Worlds. And convinced Ifro, too, because he's a sucker. And Dave. Dave paid the price more on that one than Ifro did. Ifro snuck in a top 8 playing four Acidic Slimes in Extended.
I'm sorry, Connie, but every time I think of Acidic Slime, I just picture your face on it.
I understand that, but that's more of like hype.
This is your list.
Of hype that people have built up or whatever, and I do love the card. But
number three, it's probably the most exciting for you. I don't know really how it falls down, but number three, Trash for Treasure.
This was the card I paired with Wildfire in my first Grand Prix, and I've tried to get it to work a million other times, but I can never do it. I mean, it's like, it's
still legal and modern, right?
Yes. But it is, so it's like a much more difficult to use Tinker, right? But Tinker is one of the most powerful cards of all time.
Right.
So assuming you can, you know, jump through the loopholes of getting something in your graveyard, and graveyard hate is not a popular strategy or sideboard strategy or whatever, then this card lets you cheat extensively. In that Grand Prix, I had four Wildfire, but I also had three Sundering Titan and three Mindslaver, and you could just go like turn two Signet, like turn three Thirst for Knowledge, turn four Trash for Treasure, like I have a Titan in play, blow up all your lands, whatever. Now a Wildfire, blow up your lands later. I also had Crucible Worlds with Artifact Lands. So there was a lot of like little synergies with it. It's just a card that, I don't know, it lets you cheat mana, and it's, you know, takes a little bit of work. Like I said, it's not, like, the problem with engines in general, if they don't take work, everybody jumps on them. It's like, you know, this card's obviously broken, let's play it. So I like to like find the ones that are very, very powerful, but, you know, have hidden potential.
All right. Number two on your list, Abyssal Persecutor.
He only made number two. I played him in Vintage with the Bitter Ordeals. I had three of these guys in Vintage.
I'm sorry. I did not realize the Bitter Ordeal deck was very recent.
This was Vintage Worlds, the 0-0-1 last year.
Oh, I didn't realize it was... Okay. So, tell me more about that whole situation. I mean, this is obviously a very Connolly situation.
He's just a very powerful card that, like, you know, people are playing Swords, obviously, in that format, but besides that, there was really no way to get rid of him. He just wins very quickly. I had, like, Edicts of my own. I had my own Swords. I think I had maybe a Vindicate. I can't remember. But he's just, I don't know, he's just a huge guy that, again, you have to work at a little bit, but he's very powerful. He saw some moments in Standard. I don't know if he'll ever get there in Modern. I hope he does.
What about you and Ninja the Deep Hours?
That was extended. That was not Modern. Modern did not exist then, but that was also an awesome deck.
Okay.
I got Gavin Verhey to win a PTQ with that deck, and we both top 32 to Grand Prix with it. But that was a sweet deck. Also built about 5 hours before the tournament or whatever. I have a habit of doing that.
Not anymore, you don't.
A lot of work.
Now, you're going to show up with a deck. It's going to be a team deck, and you're going to do some winning.
Yeah, but the team does that. They build the deck 5 hours before the tournament.
Best players in the world. They don't do that.
All right, fair.
It's okay. Number one, Connolly Woods Magic Card. It's pretty easy to guess at this point because a lot of the other ones have been said here. Necrotic Ooze.
Yes. I put him above Abyssal Persecutor just because he has so many possibilities. Like, Abyssal Persecutor is pretty straightforward. Like, you play it, you got to figure out a way to kill it after you kill your opponent. Like, pretty simple. But this guy, there's just, like, infinite things. I mean, I played him in Legacy, played him in Extended last year. I've tried him in Modern. I played him in Atlanta earlier this year in Modern Extended, even though current Extended is not really a thing. But yeah, he's just a super powerful card. Currently in Standard, he's good with like Civilized Scholar and Grim Grin plus Bloodline Keeper. Although I don't know if that deck is good enough, but that synergy is cool. The pieces that go around it might not work. But yeah, I just love the card. There's just so much stuff you can do with it. And it's one of those cards that will be played in most formats for as long as it's around, just because it's so unique. There's no card like it. So whenever there's a new activated ability that seems ridiculous on some card, all of a sudden it's like, oh, but we can, you know, cheat on it by playing this guy. Like a... what's the one that make Gigantomancer? Like, that guy's like, you can't ever play that card. It's terrible. But all of a sudden, if it's on a 4-mana body, it's like, oh, I can turn things into a 7-7. It's pretty sweet. So, I don't know.
Have you found a way to get infinite turns with them yet?
I'm sure there's a way to get infinite turns, but I haven't looked at them. It would only be in Vintage, I'm sure, and I don't know if that's possible. Is there a creature that takes an extra turn? I don't think so.
I don't think so. That's what I'm wondering. How deep have you gone on this card?
I haven't looked at it for Vintage ever, so I'm assuming if that exists, it would be in Vintage. But although I don't think there's a creature that lets you take infinite turns. There might be like one of the like plane or portal guys that like attacks and then like you sacrifice him after he's done damage to take an extra turn. I don't know. Maybe there is. Jinjin of the Riding Dongalong or whatever. I don't know their names. I'm sure one of them has it, though.
Connolly Woods' new invitational card. You heard it here
Jinjin
first.
Jinjin of the Riding Dongalong?
Yeah.
What? That's a good card. That is a solid...
It's like a 4-3 horsemanship, and then whenever...
When Evan Irwin made it to the Invitational, the last Invitational... I noticed how I turned the camera there for dramatic effect.
You did.
You need to work on that.
You did.
He had like a little thing for his magic show where people like outside users got to submit cards for
is
him.
Is that really was that where Ding Dong the
no
horse rider came?
But
the first
my
time
card I submitted was like colorless black shroud, and it had some evasion. I think it was like Swamp Walk or something. And when it dealt damage, it was like a 1/1. When it dealt damage to them, you get to take a wish for a card out of your sideboard and then lose life equal to the green mana cost of that card. It's pretty sweet.
That is pretty sweet.
So it was like a Shadow Mage Infiltrator Wish combination. So that would probably be on my list if it existed, but it doesn't. Wizards. You can use Dong Dong. I will not copyright it.
Well, there you have it. Hopefully Luis and I scored pretty well on this list. From my recollection, I think we did pretty well. But Luis would have something to say about ones that you left off that he definitely thinks should be.
There are probably some that I left off that people would argue for, and they're probably right. There's probably, you know, there's a ton of Connolly cards, obviously.
Wow. Taking credit for all kinds of Magic cards now. They're all Connolly cards.
I mean, I may have pulled some strings to get them printed. I'm not saying anything about that.
Didn't bother to win any tournaments with them, but you got them printed?
First of all, I don't win any tournaments. I'm terrible. But assuming I had one tournament.
Where's Matt Nass when you need him?
Well, he's worse than me, so it's okay.
Didn't he with the Oakland and the Grand Prix and the...
Yes, he did beat me with elves, thank you. Thank you for reminding me of that.
I wasn't sure if you'd remembered, because anyway. There you have it, top 8 Connolly cards. I'm sure 2-3 years from now, this list will be far outdated, and you will have a whole new string of Acidic Slime-esque Magic cards that we can sit here and talk about.
Who's watching backlogged 2 or 3 year old Magic TV episodes?
Our editor is far aware of the views that our old videos get. Some of them are just huge cult hits. Others,
like The Price of Lands, I'm sure it's very popular. I'm sure people right now are sitting at home eating popcorn watching The Price of Lands episode. You giant idiot. Giant idiot. Would you like to wrap this one up?
No, this is like, my life is one big outtake at this point, so we could just sit here and keep this one going forever.
This isn't even an outtake. He hasn't even yelled cut yet.
I know. I suppose this is all real. This is happening. Well, there you have it. You know what? 2 years from now, we'll go back. We'll see how many hits this one's getting, and then we'll update your situation. See how many more tournaments you lose to Matt Ness.
I'm not going
to
even extrapolate from there. We'll just cut it.
Well, there you go. Thanks, everyone, for watching.